On episode 5 of Pick Rich's Brain, we're talking all things music, motivation, success, drumming, and drum teching with my buddy, Jon Hull.
Drummer, percussionist, author, composer, songwriter, producer, professional speaker, actor, Rich Redmond has left his mark on thousands of songs, including over 21 number one hits, over 30 years of been there, done that, wisdom and knowledge in the Nashville music business. This is Pick Rich's Brain.
What's up, everybody? Rich Redmond here, beautiful Nashville, Tennessee, Crash Studios, and you're watching the 5th episode of Pick Rich's Brain. We're talking all things music, motivation, success, and of course, drumming live right here from Nashville, Tennessee. And my guest today is the one and only Jon Hull, 1-800-DRUM-TECH, leave out the U, DRM Tech. You better lock it down. 1-800-DRUM-TECH. John is a dear friend. No H in the name, John. And what's the Instagram handle there, buddy?
At Johnny Fletch Drums.
Is it J-O-N-N-Y?
Fletch, F-L-E-T-C-H, okay. Drums.
Is there a story behind Fletch?
It's my middle name.
All right, very, very, that's right. I should know this. But John and I have been working together 5 years, so we're gonna get into that. His whole life story, you know, it emerged from Ohio and his college years and coming to Nashville and, you know, making his dreams come true. But of course, behind the camera, our good friend Jim McCarthy, jimmccarthyvoiceovers.com. He is our muse. He is a modern day Ed McMahon, actually funnier. Funnier than Ed McMahon.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
And yes, he's got his own microphone. He's very excited about it. And he's going to be fielding your questions. And God, if you need anything in Nashville in terms of videography or photography or voiceovers, Jim is your man. Jim, do we have questions for episode 5 of Pick Rich's Brain?
You know, actually...
We don't.
No, we do. Okay. Tori Dent McDonald.
I love Tori.
A good question regarding John. And this is something that you expanded upon, Rich, was when John reached out to you, how did that all go down? You were pretty tenacious.
Very tenacious. Yes.
So, yeah, the story is, I mean, John, you are 25 years old.
I'll be 26 in a month.
1 month, you'll be 26. Great. And see, I moved to Nashville when I was 26. But your story is, you're from Ohio, Chillicothe.
Chillicothe.
Don't ask me to spell that. That's like chupacabra. I mean, that's like one of those, yeah. Okay. And so then, you know, how long have you been playing drums?
I've been playing for 26, playing for 13 years now. I started when I was 13 years old.
All right. Good. Yeah. And so, like, who are some of your early influences drumming-wise?
Well, my dad... You know, being an 80s rock guy, I grew up with Van Halen, Def Leppard, Rush.
You're still into that.
Brian
stuff,
Adams.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
All right, right.
People hate, but, you know.
No, it's good stuff. It's good Rush, stuff. The Holy Trinity. You know, and they were in a Judd Apatow movie. That is success right there. Yeah. I tell you what. So drumming, and you have a background in music education. So you're kind of a product of the schools. You were in Rhythm X, right?
Yep, Rhythm X out of Columbus, Ohio. I started as early as I could in elementary school. In the concert band, marching band, jazz band, pep band, pretty much any education-based program that I could do for free. You know, it's free education, free experience.
Yeah. And you had some bands out of school, too, like some cover bands?
That yep, cover bands. I had an original band for a little while. Of course, it flopped because... You know, what original band does.
You're only
these
as
days.
Strong as your weakest member or the commitment of each member, right?
Yeah. It was fun while it lasted, but yeah. You know, it was a good experience.
And then you went to college, you got an associate's degree.
Associates.
Right?
In music business, and it's music management is the umbrella.
Okay.
I did music business and music production.
Nice.
So it's a side by side deal, basically. So you do all of the business classes. For you know, music law, et cetera.
God, I wish I had taken some of those
and
things.
Then you do music production mm-hmm. alongside, which is all of the studio engineering and live sound and recording and mixing. And
I'll have to say, like, all those skill sets really paid off for you because to those listeners out there, I will say, John has been my drum tech working with me for 5 years. And since we have the same schedule, we became friends, and I also realized his immense skill set in so many different things. So I involve John in everything that I'm doing. He involves me with everything that he's doing. So when it comes to drumming in the modern world, all the digital editing, he helped me with that. Writing my Fundamentals of Drumming book for kids was published by Modern Drummer. He helped me with that. He provides drums for all my corporate events. texts for me in the studio. He's the engineer here at Crash Studios, so I can just focus on being the artiste that I want to be and kind of execute. And then John is sitting right where Jim is sitting, just running all the sessions. So, so you were super tenacious. Yeah. You decided that you were going to come to Nashville, and you didn't really know who I was, but you saw me at the PAS.
Yes, I knew roughly who you were. I mean, I didn't grow up, you know, very saturated in the country music scene, just because, you know, 80s rock and Southern Ohio is kind of the black hole of the country. So I knew who you were based on, you know, playing with Jason Aldean, and I've always subscribed to Modern Drummer magazine. So you're in every magazine with ads, doing interviews, write-ups. Yeah. So, you know, after
we love Modern Drummer.
Yeah, after several years of reading about you, I was like, well, I got to check the guy out, because, I mean, nobody's in Modern Drummer that much.
Oh,
so check out the clinic. You
know? That's really so, cool. You know. We love Modern Drummer. I've been reading it since the 70s, man. It's like been around for a long time.
It's a lot longer than
story. Shut up. Anyways.
You know what we got to give a shout out to?
The Tipping Chair Tavern.
The Tipping Chair Tavern, absolutely. And also the Predators.
Uh-huh. The Predators.
The Predators
are
the
killing it.
Stanley Cup.
How about that, Nashville?
Okay.
And I was in the house band. I was in the Predators house band in the year 2000, 2001, 2002. It was $100, a free hockey game, and a hot meal, and a chance to be on ESPN, and we were. It was a lot of fun.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
Tori Deb McDonald says, Tipping Chair Tavern rocks.
Tipping Chair Tavern is amazing. If you're up in the Hartford area in Connecticut, our Jim and I's great friend Jeff Vitti, he opened a place. It's been up around for 2.5 years. Voted best wings, fantastic bar food. If you're into bar food, I mean, I like raining on some chili fries sometimes. But also, Miss Connecticut designed the menu there. So if you want to eat super clean and super healthy, and then polish it down with a Pinot Noir, you can do that. Pinot Grigio, it's there. And live music 7 nights a week. We're probably talking 355 days a year live music. The only live music venue in Connecticut to have live music 7 nights a week. So we want to thank our first sponsor, the Tipping Chair Tavern. Thanks, guys. Check them out, tippingchairtavern.com. Right?
Right on. Thumbs up for them. Thumbs up for the Preds.
Yes.
Here we go for the Preds in the Stanley Cup Finals. Looking forward to that.
Mm-hmm.
And but basically, somebody, you know, so you continue the story. I remember you telling me that John just really vigorously reached out to you. You were like a dog on a bone.
Yeah, basically, yeah. So what happened was, I mean, the clinic, of course, is awesome. You know, it's a crash course clinic. Mm. You know, a lot of people have seen it. If you haven't, you have to go see the clinic because it's great. It's educational and very informative.
Stop.
Awesome. Anyway, so I check it out, and of course, he's a Nashville guy. You know, he's accomplished all things in Nashville. So me wanting to go to Nashville, I jump to the back of the line. Yeah, as people file up, I kept skipping to the back of the line, so I could be the guy that procrastinates around.
Yeah.
And chit-chats a little bit longer before they kick us out.
Well, you took a great risk. So, you either were going to get the most time with me or the least time.
Yeah.
But it was great, and we chatted, and then you ended up interning with me to get your college degree.
And so
you were following New Voice Entertainment around in the studio scene in Nashville, and we were hanging out talking a lot about drums, and I said, no, you're not going to get a complete education until you come out on the road and you see what this is all about. And your first gig, I remember, especially that haircut that you had, was Crew Stadium in Ohio, right? So, like, what was it?
Soccer stadium.
How many people were there?
Probably 40,000 people.
Yeah, that was really, really cool. And then you got a chance to, you know, sit behind the kit. We got to know each other. You met all the powers that be. And before you know it, boom, we hired you.
The next
and you're
week.
On 5 years. And John is just, everything is white glove. He maintains relationships with all my sponsors. He sets up and tears down the drums every day. He maintains them. He tunes them. He cleans them. Everything is super consistent. We have a hidden language now after 5 years of working together. He knows when that water bottle is about to be empty. He knows when I need a sweat towel. He knows when I need chapstick. He knows the directions of my fans. We have a rhythm every day of all the things that we do to keep the day consistent, because the road will chew you up and spit you out. So I'm having some normalcy, especially for me, the one thing I like to do every day, as you know, is like I will go find a Starbucks and I will get my iced coffee with coconut milk, because it just makes me feel consistent. And you make me feel consistent. The dressing room, I've got my practice pad there. And it's awesome.
Yeah,
so thank you, man, for everything you do.
Thank you. Awesome. So that was no surprises. You can't have any surprises.
That was your be-all, end-all goal. You wanted that.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you just went out and made it happen, come hell or high water.
That's definitely a lesson for all those folks out there that want to do something. Set your sights on it. Write it down. Repeat it as a mantra, and then figure out how to connect the dots to make things happen. And usually, it has to do a lot with geography.
geography, and people. Yep, and educate yourself on what you're getting into. Mm-hmm. You know, don't just come in expecting that you're gonna come in and tech or work in the studio or work on a live touring crew if you don't know anything about it.
Yeah.
You know, same with any business. You're not going to go to an interview and say, hey, I would love to be an investment manager.
Mm-hmm. I'd love to be an investment banker, but I know nothing about finance.
Yeah, so educate yourself, you know, figure out what you're going to do, develop the skill set, and then, you know, you just dive in and just pursue it.
Sky's the limit.
Yeah.
Within the realm of drum teching, what do you feel you are best at?
I think I'm best at getting drum sounds that the particular artist or engineer wants, whether it's live or in the studio. I think with my history of being in, you know, all the different types of bands, tuning concert bass drums and tuning timpani and tuning marching snare drums and, you know, marching bass lines.
You're fast.
Concert snares.
You're fast and you're consistent and you're flexible. And the challenge, I will say, is then playing in a gig like Aldean's situation is that we're in the studio, we're in stadiums, we're in arenas, we're in outdoor amphitheaters, we're indoors, we're outdoors, different seasons, things do different things to the heads. That front of house guy, our front of house guy, Chris Stevens, award-winning front of house guy, he's looking to John to provide that consistent drum sound that we've established for ourselves every single day. So I know John knows what I like. I like a bass drum thumping low end with some high end snap. I like a snare drum that's got some low mids and it's got body to it, but tons of crack. And then the toms that have a slight pitch bend that are a little bit on the lower side, but still have attack. And so he does that, and he does it by ear every single day.
Yeah.
And I'll brag on you now that your career has been expanding and you've gotten thumbs up from other industry players in the industry. Like your Harry McCarthy's, who owns Drum Paradise, he's a big fan of yours. You drum teched on the new Paramore record, and you drum teched on the Story of the Year. So
it's not out yet.
And you went out with OAR with my buddy Chris Kulos to go out and so it was a whole other situation where you were sitting up Ableton Live and keyboards and doing drums and awesome. So we're very proud of John here.
Do you like sharing him, Rich?
I don't like sharing John, but I know it's inevitable.
I'm inevitable to you.
No, I know. What's the deal is that once life is a team sport, and so I just say, look at John. I love the fact that I can bring John opportunities all the time. I say, hey, we're cutting 6 tracks today in Crash Studio. Hey, we're doing a. What are some other fun things we're doing? Oh, we're working on, we did a sample library for Nashville Sampling Company, where I basically, Justin Miller, who's a great programmer and a keyboardist and a producer in town, and Garrett Goodwin, our friend, the drummer for Carrie Underwood, came to me. They started a company called Nashville Sampling Co., and Garrett basically sampled all of his drums, and I'm the first signature artist in their product line, where I sampled all of my drums in a world-class studio called Black River Entertainment. It's called also, the hipsters in Nashville know it as Ronnie's Place. And we set up a lot of microphones and a lot of signal path. And I recorded all of my drums in a million ways. Like each snare drum is like as soft as humanly possible to as loud as humanly possible. And I don't even know how many hi-hat variations, like
thousands.
And it took two 21-hour days or something like that?
Two 16-hour days just playing, not including getting sounds and levels.
Two 16-hour days, and composers, artists, producers are going to be able to download that soon. And as an added bonus, there's going to be MIDI loops. So John and I are over here on my Roland kit, as many hours a day as we can squeeze in, recording user-friendly loops for songwriters. Yeah. So you're working on a song and you want to feel like... You just pull it up as a MIDI file, drop it on the grid, change the tempo, and insert any of my samples on top of that MIDI file, and I am in your box. I am in, I am single ladies. I am in your laptop.
This is gonna earn the explicit rating on iTunes now.
Uh-oh, yeah. we're gonna have to pull that out.
No, can we verify that you're 18 years or older?
Yes. There was some explicit ratings on a couple of the first podcasts, I don't know why.
I don't understand that either. talk about the...
So John and I do these things together. So the point is that I'm always looking for opportunities to bring to him because I am so turned on with my friend's success. Mm-hmm. That makes me happy.
Yeah, and it's reciprocated because I couldn't do any of this without, you know, of course, Rich being a champion to me and bringing me along and trusting me to do the things that I do for him. at the same time, you know, I've got to really come to the table and deliver, you know, when we're doing a session or something like that. Like,
there were some speed bumps along the way. I mean, there was always a learning curve. I was like,
always the learning curve.
John, this thing is upside down. You know, I mean, like, this was the early years. This was like 5 years ago. And now you've got your rhythm, you got your system, and he could set up a world-class touring drum set and break it down. You break it down in 13 minutes.
11
minutes. Because our crew on the road challenged him to say, John, you're a little slow, you're in our way. And he's like, oh yeah? And he literally fine-tuned it to an art.
Now I wait on them at the truck, so.
Right. He's like this.
That's right.
Come on, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a true testament to honing your craft.
Yeah, absolutely.
But talk about the relationship between the tech and the drummer. Is this typical with what you guys have?
I think so. I don't know if it's this. I mean, a lot of times I think, like, on rock and roll tours, it's like there's a lot of drum techs out there that maybe aren't so professional. Maybe they're just, maybe they drink and party too much. Maybe they're late to bus call. Maybe they're not as consistent, and they get let go a lot. A lot of times there's a lot of turnover. And, you know, John's got this position locked down. Everyone's incredibly happy with him, and he's completely sober. He drinks water. And so he just shows up, and the job is going to get done every day with a smile. So that consistency is what anybody can bring to a job to consider to ensure job security. But, you know, I like mixing business with pleasure. This is a pretty common thing for me, but it makes it really, really enjoyable. If I'm going to have somebody handling my gear, it's just way better for us to have this teamwork thing that we have
absolutely.
Going. And we can look at our schedule and say, hey, Johnny, on the 21st, can we crank out these songs? Hey, on the 22nd, can we film this? Modern drummer's coming over. Can we, you know? And so we have this great thing happening now. We're very, very busy. And John now has a studio similar to Crash in his house, and he's got drums all mic'd up, and he's actually a smart little businessman. He's got up-and-coming drummers that are moving to Nashville that want to create a demo video for themselves to put on YouTube, and he's engineering that. He's like, play my DW drums. They're all tuned up, ready to go. The drummer sits down, and they do a cover song.
Yep. Of their choice.
Of their choice, and John engineers and edits the audio and the video, which is really, really smart. How do they get in touch with you for that?
They get in touch via email. John@johnnyfletch.com.
JonnyFletch.com
or Instagram, Johnny Fletch Drums.
Maybe we'll put that on the. Maybe we'll do a rolling scroll of that because a lot of people are going to forget that it's two N's, no H.
Yeah.
You know.
It's more simple.
Yeah.
What does the, one thing I was going to ask you, where did the Fletch come from?
That's my middle name, actually.
Okay.
Fletcher
is my middle name. So.
I gotcha.
So I use that because Jon Hull, they're both very common last names, so every handle combination, John Hull 1,
gotcha.
John, you know, is taken, so.
Drew Connor Wilson asks, what happens when setting up a backline drum kit for a TV show?
That's a great question.
Awesome, I know Drew, we're old pals. He's in the, he's in the Bay Area. What's that awesome venue that we play out there that the people are right up there in California? It's
Mountain View.
Yeah.
View.
Drew comes every year. I've known him for a long time. Take this one, Johnny.
Yeah, so it's usually a surprise every single time. Fortunately, we're working with, you know, a big enough artist, you know, name recognition, Jason Aldean. We get a little bit of preferential treatment with our companies, especially DW, Sabian, Remo. They're really awesome to us. So when we reach out and say, hey, we have a TV show, we're playing the Today Show, we're playing Saturday Night Live, or...
Haven't done that one yet.
Yeah, or we have a big festival date that we're doing, we need a backline drum set, cymbals, heads. We reach out to either SIR or some vendor that provides those drums.
They're staging, yeah.
And they know that we, you know, are reputable customers. We're going to take care of the gear, and we're going to keep coming back to them. So they're usually pretty on top of sending us the best gear they have available. But there are times when they're a little bit saturated and you just get what you get. So you never know until you get the drums out of the cases. Sometimes it's a brand new DW drum set with the tag still on it. Sometimes it's 15 years old and the lugs are
rusted
so tight you can't hardly, you know, tune
But you know, I mean, these, some of these like morning shows, Drew, are like, you know, we fly into New York City, we land at 4 p.m, we all go to a pub and you know, have a little fish and chips, you know, when in Rome or something, and then we go try to fall asleep because the crew lobby call is 2 a.m, and at 4 a.m, this guy's pulling drums out of his cases, and you know, Al Roker isn't even there yet, the guy making coffee isn't even, no one's there, and he's like, you know, in Manhattan, like getting drums ready for me, and then I stroll in at 5 a.m, and I'm like, these sound amazing, thanks, John.
Yeah, but it's fast paced though, so you have all of these moving parts. You know, I mean, setting the drum setup is very low on the priority list of the people that are actually putting on the TV show or the production. So,
yeah.
You know, they're worried about getting the artists in and getting the band in and getting the camera blocking. So I have to work as fast as I can, A, to get set up comfortable and right for Rich.
So he's got drum tacks, he's got gaff, he's got lug locks, he's got extra... plastic sleeves, he's got extra washers, he's got drum keys, he's ready to go.
Drumsticks, make sure you have drumsticks, because I can't, you know, I'm not going to tell Rich, hey, go into the road case and get a box of sticks and load your suitcase up for this. You know, like, that's my responsibility. So I have all of these things that Rich needs, you know, his travel click rig and everything else. So it's my job to quickly get set up. And fortunately, we've been working together for long enough. I know the sounds that he wants, and I know the sounds that we need for audio. I know his setup really well, so I can piece everything together quickly so we can get everything line checked, sounding good for TV, because it is on a very strict time schedule.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have all afternoon to suss out sounds or,
yeah,
you know, get things right for TV. Like, it's got to happen right now, so when the cameras turn on, like, you know, we're ready to go.
It is low on the priority list, but it is so important, because you need to have your drummer, because your drummer is only, the band is only as good as the drummer, and the drum, like, you'll know when your band is ready for a drum tech and when your organization is ready. And the tipping point for us was, I was playing The Voice in Burbank, and me and the band all had the same, I said, guys, if you want me to prep this drum set, I don't have a tech, I need to be there at least 60 minutes before the rest of the band. It didn't happen, we all arrived at the same time, then trouble, LA traffic, the drums were 30 minutes late, which threw everything off. They come out of the cases hot. They hadn't been touched in forever. I have no tech. Meanwhile, all the stagehands, who all know me, the stagehands, the camera guys, they're all the same guys that work on these television shows. They're like, hey, Richie, what's going on, man? How's Nashville? Are we ready? They're looking at me like this, like, you know, we love you, but I mean, this is union, man. We got to get this done. Yeah, I'm like, guys, I don't know what to tell you. I need 10 minutes. And I'm there with like a drum dial, just trying to get this stuff tuned up as quickly as I possibly can, sit down and make a buck. And they're like, okay, we're running this song with Jason and the three contestants. Ready? Here we go. Meanwhile, Nate Morton and Steve, his tech, are watching at me just going, you poor dude, you know? So, so it's really... When the organization grows and you have 100 employees, the crew goes over and makes everything happen. The band comes over. Everybody has their very specific job categories and statements of work that they have to handle, and boom, it just works like a finely tuned machine.
Right on.
Hope that answers the question. If there's anything else you want to know, like detail-wise, you know, let me know, Drew, but hopefully that covers pretty much everything.
You could tell that John is a millennial or a post-millennial, because there's a beautiful camera here, and he's looking at his phone. Because people are used to... There's a phone, you better look at it.
Ryan Blackwell says, do you use moon gels or another type of dampening? What's your favorite?
Drum tacks. Four to attack. Wait a minute. Four to a pack. Drum tacks. Yeah. You know, now, I mean, moon gels were the jam. And I look at them now, they look very strange sitting on, it's like a melted gummy worm.
Yes, and well, they just have, like, they're not the most practical to use. They're a little bit limited.
They get dirty.
They get dirty very easily. They don't really stick to anything unless it's sitting on top.
It has to be on top. Whereas a drum tack can sit underneath the head,
yes,
underneath the cymbal.
So we use drum tack, one drum tack on the bottom of each head, just to take a little bit of the really high overtones on the decay of the drum. But sometimes if you're in a pinch, if you don't have enough drum tacks, or you have something really wrong, or you're trying to get a really tubby snare sound, I always have a roll of gaff tape with me, and we use, you know, gaff tape,
paper towels,
you know, towels, what, you know, whatever fits the application, but always have a pack or two of drum tacks on me and a roll of gaff tape, and 99% of the time you can make anything happen with those. Funny story about this.
And big fat snares are cool too.
Big fat snares are really great for really like at a live show. If you don't have time to do a snare change, throw a big fat snare on there. Poof, you've got a Don Henley 1970 snare drum immediately.
So smart, Chris Mazzarisi, great guy.
So it's I got a quick story. When we were in Australia, speaking of the backline drum sets and surprises, we had to do a live TV show, but we were miming to the track. So what happened was we got the backline drum set. They sent the wrong Zildjian cymbals, and they weren't TV cymbals. So they were loud, so we didn't have muted drum heads. So I had a roll of gaff tape and hand towels. I had to take all the drums off, fold the towels up, tape them to the bottom of the heads, tape over, I had to get two sets of cymbals, tape them together, tape over the logos.
Is that what we did?
Yeah, wow. I had to actually make video heads for the TV show because the backline company over there has almost no experience doing these types of things and knowing, hey, we're coming in and miming on a TV show because we're flying in last second. It was a little bit of a
It was the Australian Country Music Awards.
Yes.
And we were miming. And so people, if you don't know what miming is, it's the old Dick Clark thing where you the track plays and you literally go through the motions of pretending you're playing on the song. And you have to lock up exactly with what you're doing to make it convincing for the viewer. Yeah. And you don't want to be trying to hear, you know, the song and you know, real cymbals and real kick drums and stuff.
Because the vocals are always live.
The vocals
singer
are live.
Always sings, but the band, because we have risers and all this gear to plug in, roll on stage and plug in 30 seconds for live TV, there's not time to make sure everything's correct.
Yeah, you know what we become at that point? Become actors. We're acting. We're playing ourselves.
So
fine line, guys.
You make
fine line.
Make
you can also do Remo silent strokes. Remo silent strokes heads are very effective for. You can use them to practice in your apartment, or you could use them for video cymbals, which are video heads, which is great.
Which is a good thing to have if you have the space to take them in a road case. But if not, always have some gaff tape on you, drum tacks. It saves the day. So
six beats of separation.
Yeah. Masks. What's up, guys?
You know, it says we have set up a kit that will cover any and all genres of music, as we have a myriad of visiting musicians and celebrities.
Yes.
We're looking, though, to make our kit a five-piece. Any recommendations for sizes that will allow for tuning to cover the gamut? And anything you can point out that is typical oversight?
Well, you know, what's in common nowadays is to go 12, 14, 16, or 13, 16, 18 for more rock, pop type artists. Jazz and fusion has always been associated with more like 8, 10, 12, 14 or 10, 12, 14, those smaller sizes.
I'd say, I mean, you could get by 12, 16, 18, and if you're doing the jazz thing, you could lose the 18.
And just 12,
you could tune
16.
The 12 and 16 up enough to where they'll sound pretty jazzy, especially with the right head on it. But
12, 16, 18, and if you're, you know, some rock and rollers are not going to miss the 18, you can do what? 10, 12, 16.
Yeah.
You could do 10, 12, 16, or you could just be super slick and have a lot of hardware around and just buy the drums, buy 10, 12, 14, 16, or 10, 12, 16, 18, and then just let the drummer come in, have enough hardware to customize a drum set.
Yeah.
Right on. Yeah. At what point did you realize that you were kind of living a dream job?
I realized right away. You know, I mean, it was fresh out of college. You know, I was 21 years old at the time when I jumped on the bus and started working with them on the road. But it was really close to the same time I actually moved to Nashville too.
Yeah.
You know, I met him while I was in college when I was marching Rhythm X, and we kind of developed the relationship while he was touring. I was in college. You know, we worked on some projects here and there, but when it all started coming together, and you know, I was climbing on a tour bus 6 months after I graduated college, it was like, if you would have told me that a year ago, I would never have imagined that. So it's a pretty right away thing to me. Like, I expected to come to Nashville and work for 10 years and then be lucky enough to get in a Sprinter van with a trailer, you know.
Yeah. And John's been really smart. Like, if you can, do smart things. He's already paid off most of his college loans. He's about to pay off his car, and he owns a home, and he rents the rooms out. He's looking at a second property. I mean, I just was not that smart at that age. I was so focused on just playing drums, playing drums, playing drums, playing drums. The money will come. But, you know, hey, if you have some regular income coming in, be smart with it. And he's super smart with it. He's inspired me. So.
And what I can say about that is seek mentors that are doing the things that you have interest in or want to do down the road. Like, nice. Obviously, you know, I work with Rich, but he's a really great mentor. So he's experienced everything in the music industry that you can experience and accomplished everything that you can ever want to accomplish, especially like on a drumming side and on the business side. Hmm. So you got guys like Rich who have been there and done it and are, you know, still doing it and surviving. And then outside of that, like whether it's, you know, real estate or business or finance or whatever, track down people that you know are successful and approach them and say, hey, I am new to this, or I'm learning about this and I would love to, you know, pick your brain or take you out to coffee and talk about it. And you never know what kind of relationship or friendship you can get out of that. Nice. And then you have a mentor that's built in with a friendship. Yeah. You can call at any time and get information or get advice. And I think that's more valuable than almost any education that you can get in school or, you know, out of a textbook or anything like that. Yeah, being able to pick up the phone and call somebody and say, hey, what do you think about this? Like, what are we looking at here?
Yeah, I mean, every time I come up to do sound check and John's in his little cubby by the click tracks and all that stuff, he's reading a Dave Ramsey book or a Tony Robbins book. Or
good for you.
Yeah. Smart. Master time killer.
Is John a typical person coming to Nashville, would you say, is, or what attracted, what, how did he get on your radar?
Well, he just put himself out there and just like literally started a conversation. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But then I saw the fire in his eyes to just learn. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But I'm kind of faced with that every day. People were like, hey, I'm going to take you out to coffee. And you know what I mean? It's like I could float away on a river of coffee. But he just proved himself right away, like, oh my God, this guy knows how to tune drums, and he's a good little player, and he wants to do this, and he's moldable. And, you know, when you first get hired for a company, people are looking like, oh man, wow, this guy's, he's really good. And, you know, this is typical in a lot of businesses. He's young. We can get him for a pretty good price. Mm-hmm. You know, that happens. I mean, that happened for me when I was 27 years old. Moved to Nashville and you're down on playing on Lower Broadway for tips. That's a pretty good price. Tens of thousands of hours of experience, and I'm playing for $5 bills in a pickle jar. You know, but you just grow. You just grow, and I'm sure you've gotten raises, and you just, it works out good. You know?
Yeah. Stick around.
Absolutely.
Just show up.
Show up every day
with a smile on your face, ready to take direction, ready to execute, and I think great things will happen.
Yeah. Stay open-minded. Yeah,
getting back to the financial piece of it, because not everybody has the wherewithal. You know, this is America after all. Why would you be financially responsible?
Right.
What set you on that course? What was one thing profoundly that impacted you that made you realize that, hey, tomorrow's not promised to anybody.
Tomorrow.
And the gig could end next week.
I can have an aneurysm right now.
Well, I think you pretty much said it.
I hope not.
Me too.
Yeah.
That'd be really bad. I think you pretty much said it. The gig could end tomorrow. Mm-hmm.
But not. It's very uncommon for people your age to think that way. I know I do.
Right, but I mean, I see it all the time. Yeah. I
think it has to do with alcohol consumption. We're not smart because of alcohol consumption. But John doesn't consume alcohol.
I don't know about that.
So he's very, very smart.
Anyway, I guess back on the subject.
And he has a pretty girlfriend, and he didn't even have to drink alcohol to meet her. Yeah. How did you guys meet?
We were introduced through mutual friends, actually.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So match.com?
Bobby and Lori Mertz.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. I know the matchmakers. Yeah. I know.
They were friends with her. They were friends with me. Okay. And
she didn't know she was going to be on the podcast.
Sandwiched us together.
She had no idea.
No.
Sorry.
What does she think of what you do?
I mean, she's a aspiring singer and songwriter herself in Nashville, so I think she's... I mean, I'd like to say she's proud of what I do, and she's happy to like tell people, oh, this is my boyfriend, and he does this. I mean, I'm working in the industry and making a living and doing it. So,
that's cool. You should be very proud.
I think that's
honest day's work. Yeah. It's honest day's work, and we don't have to dig ditches.
That's right. I have dug ditches.
As have I.
He's baled hay, literally.
Shoveled manure, literally.
Yeah.
I've pulled wire that was like the thickness of a silver dollar.
It is not fun.
Four at a time in the rain, and I realized,
That's not smart.
No, I really questioned my life choices at that point.
It's terrible.
Josh Gabriel, he's been chomping at the bit.
What's up, Josh?
He is asking tips on tuning 16 and 18 inch floor toms.
Ooh, all right.
To get rid of overtones.
All right.
John, what's your method? Because you, I will say this, I've been playing drums. This is how I judge my life. Pre-Star Wars, post-Star Wars. Okay, so Star Wars just celebrated 40 years, which means I've been playing drums for around 40 years. People go, what? I don't even know people that old. You've been playing drums that long? And it's just, and John tunes faster than I do. He's just so good. But he does it every single day.
Yeah.
All day, every day. Yeah. You become a master at what you do every single day.
Yeah.
So what is your philosophy?
My philosophy is... I mean, it goes along with developing any skill set. You just do it every single day, every single day, every single day.
Practice tuning.
Practice tuning.
Yeah.
And you can do it by picking up any drum you have or go to a drum shop.
Detune it.
It's a great way to work on your tuning because you have endless supplies of different kinds of drums, different drum heads, different rooms.
I'm sure Gary Forkham would be like, hey, buddy, what are you doing? You've been here 8 hours. Oh, I'm just practicing my tuning.
Yeah, I'm sure they wouldn't mind, yeah. You know. But seriously, though, tune all the drums you have in every room in your house, okay? Take your drum into a room, take the drum head off, put it on there, and stay there until you get the drum sounding how you want it to sound. Mm-hmm. So get it in tune with itself. If you have to do a little bit of dampening on the top or the bottom, depending on whether you want lots of ring or no ring or how thuddy you want it, stay there until you get it how you want it. Take the head back off and do the same thing and work on getting to that point faster. So the second or third time you do it, you're gonna realize, oh, okay, you know, if I turn the key about this many times going around the drum head, it'll get me in the ballpark, and then, you know, you're pretty close. And then go to the next room, go into your bathroom, go to your living room, go to your garage, go outside. Outside is really great because you don't get any reverberance in the room, and it's a very dead sound. So if you want to really get your drums in tune, go outside because you can hear every little nuance for pitch differences on the lugs and stuff, and do the same thing. Mm. And then pick a different drum and do that, and do that every single day. And eventually, you get to the point where I want to tune my 12-inch rack tom to sound big, fat, and thuddy. Well, then you know exactly how to do that. You know the relationship between the top and bottom head and the tension you need to have on the top and how much dampening and muffling.
There's a couple of rules. You know, are the top and bottom heads the same pitch, or is the bottom higher, is the top? The most common thing is the bottom head slightly higher.
Slightly higher, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
So you get a little bit of a little bit of a pitch bend.
A
little bit of a pitch bend, which I enjoy. Some people don't like it. Some people like the exact same pitch. You know?
It's just the bottom head tighter, slightly less sustain just because of the pitch bend. When you have both heads resonating at the same frequency, you know, they can just sit and resonate. But when you have one resonating different, the pitch bends and it kind of cancels out some of the acoustics.
Yeah. And so, and the rule applies for snare drums, like, and maybe there'd be some people that disagree with me out there, but I usually crank the bottom head on a snare drum, and then your whole feel and tension and sound of the drum comes from the tension on the top head.
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
So I would say with what you're doing has a lot to do with self-awareness, you know, knowing what you're good at and getting into the business. What would you have to say for somebody coming into town and wanting to pursue a career in music in the Nashville scene?
Amazing question.
Basically, you know what your strengths are, and you're capitalizing them every single day.
Yeah.
You know, there are people who aspire to be what Rich is doing. Are there people, do you think there are a lot of people to do what you're doing?
I think so, yeah. I mean, just in the last 5 to 10 years that I've been pursuing the music industry, times are different. I mean, I didn't come from a time back when Rich started back in the day, but I mean, it's just, it's harder to pinpoint one specific thing you want to do and be able to go accomplish it and know that, you know, within a certain time frame, you put in the hours, you put in the work, you do it, you're going to have that opportunity. Mm-hmm. I think being flexible and being open-minded and developing multiple skill sets is your best friend, especially in Nashville, because anymore everybody knows how to do everything. You know, everybody's a great drummer, but they're also engineers, and they can program and use Ableton and run tracks, and they can play other instruments, or they can sing, or they know the business side of music really well.
Yeah, whatever little things you can do.
Yeah, and they can manage acts and do marketing and social media marketing, and I would just say expand your skill set however you can and come to town with an open mind. Pursue what you want to do, obviously, but don't limit yourself.
But I like how you said, I will be a drum tech, which is like I'm writing a chapter on this in two books that I'm working on right now. One is about the crash concept, and one is about how to actually navigate the music business. And you'll have some quotes in there and stuff.
Well, thank you.
But my thing was, when I moved to town, there was a wonderful drummer named Tommy Wells, and he said, Rich, don't let people see you tuning a drum or pushing cases, because
they will pigeonhole
you immediately. And I said, wow, it kind of stuck with me. I just knew that I was going to play drums no matter what.
Yeah.
You were open to this whole concept of doing this skill and crushing it and being able to set up a lifestyle for yourself at your age, which is awesome. Because when I was your age, because of that decision, it was a broken down Toyota pickup truck. It was a ramen noodles. It was Jim Riley and I living together in a one-bedroom apartment.
But it's paid off now. I mean,
it was the long games.
Yeah.
But a lot of people come to town wanting to do what Rich does.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Which is akin to, and I'll bring up Vaynerchuk because I'm a big fan of
Gary V.
Yeah.
Gary V, thank you for answering my friend Jim McCarthy yesterday. He's been tweeting you for 2 years.
Right.
Thank you, Gary V.
Finally.
Yes. Gary,
but, you know, I asked him a good question.
Yeah.
Okay, and it got his attention. So, yeah. But he always talks about, you know, people going into, especially with the age of entrepreneurship that everybody, it's cool to put that on the title of your Instagram description.
What's that?
Entrepreneur, sure. CEO, things of that nature. And his big thing is like, look, not everybody is cut out to do that. You know, it's okay to be number five guy at Facebook.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, you know, for you to come into this, it's kind of refreshing to realize, no, I'm really good at this, and this is what I'm going to capitalize on. I'm going to make it work.
Sure.
And not a lot of people have that self-awareness that he always talks about, which, by the way,
that's a maturity. Anybody, there's a maturity there.
Yeah.
There's always an outlet. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter what you want to do. There's an outlet to be able to do it.
And I still think you should be playing, but you can lead a horse to water. Like, if you are so inclined to play, you're meeting a lot of people, you'll do it. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I keep you so damn busy that we do this thing.
And I love that.
But know? Let me ask you this. Back in the day, in the late 90s, when you came here, Rich, you mentioned that don't let somebody see you tuning ahead or pushing a case.
Which sounds harsh. It does. But it's.
But do you think you could change your perception over the years? Like pushing cases and tuning heads first and then becoming an in-demand drummer. I think in this day and age of social media.
I think it's a little different now. I mean, look at, you know, Jim Handley has been working at a cartridge company for over 20 years, and he subbed for Journey. You know, he filled in for Dean Castronova, and he works all the time playing the drums. Yeah. So I think things have, we can multitask now. We can do more. Take it from me. I wear a lot of hats. Jim wears a lot of hats, you know.
Absolutely.
We're all wearing a lot of hats. So I think that is lightened up, but in the 90s, that was some advice I got, and I just followed it. I was like, I'm going to play drums. Even if it just doesn't pay, it's not paying. How am I going to do this? So my dad said, Rich, you got this gig with this cool guy on a major label. He's paying you $150 a show. You have to do 100 shows to make $15,000. It's tough to get by on $15,000, even 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And I was like, I know, Dad. I'll have to do some other stuff on the side, like wait tables and play drums for other people. But I mean, I was excited about that $15,000, you know. But I wasn't as excited about the $15 as much as I was getting to play and travel.
Yeah.
you know.
Well, I mean, that's the thing is that if people are aware of what you can do, and I've seen you play, John, and you're very good.
Right.
You're
very solid. Appreciate that.
It's similar to a story in the voiceover business with Don LaFontaine, who was like the god of movie trailer voiceovers.
In a world.
He invented that.
He invented In a World. Okay.
The story goes that in the studio back in the 60s or 70s, he wrote the movie trailer. That's what he used to do. The voiceover actor didn't show up.
That's amazing.
Wow. So all of a sudden, he was in the right place at the right
time. That's how a lot of people get moved up in the industry. Somebody's irresponsibility that usually has to do with forgetting to set an alarm or alcohol.
Mm-hmm. So with that being said, what's in the next 5 years for you, for Jon Hull?
Next 5 years, hopefully lots of things, lots of good things.
Love and marriage.
Love and marriage. I was about to say that.
And from an industry standpoint, obviously, you know, expanding the relationship that I have with Rich is, I mean, I wouldn't be doing anything that I'm doing now if it wasn't for Rich, you know, being a champion for me and saying, come on, kid, we're doing this. And, you know, having me come out and throwing my name around and, you know, introducing me to his friends and saying, this is my tech, John. He's the guy. Like, you know, that's invaluable. So continuing that and, you know, expanding our relationship, of course, is going to happen. But I have, you know, lots of little side businesses, you know, that I'm doing. So I record at my home studio. I play demos at the studio. I teach drum lessons. I'm starting to dabble in a little bit of real estate. So things like that that I can pursue around the touring schedule.
Yeah.
I'm going to expand all of those networks and, you know, hopefully get a student base that I can teach and give back. You know,
if somebody wants to work on their hands, John is a great choice. I mean, I tell people all the time in my clinics, I say, look, if you can't get through the Ted Reed book or the Alfred's Snare Drum Method Volume 1, you got to get with a guy like John who can walk you through these things. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you tracking people at your home studio, I mean, you'll be able to raise the price on that because the quality is incredible. And I'm actually going to start doing my corporate offering from Crash Studio where I don't even have to travel to the client. So a Cisco or a Johnson & Johnson or somebody can actually interact and see the Crash thing right here. We're going to have 3 GoPros set up over the drum set, lav mic right here into another camera, and maybe we can get crazy and we'll turn into a rock show and we'll do some lights and some dry ice. It'll be super cool, but you know who's going to be right over there engineering it? John.
Pyrotechnics.
Yeah.
Lots of fire.
Yeah, when I get paid more, John gets paid more. So yeah. Great.
Now, there's one thing, and this kind of keeps on occurring. The relationship with Jason that Rich has always been a great one. You guys have been with him for 18 years.
Yeah.
How does that transcend down to the tech level? Do you have much interaction with the artist or anything? Or
I have some interaction. He's a really easy guy to get along with, and he's very down to earth and very approachable. And you can tell just by the way the band members are, and Rich and everybody in the band and the crew, it trickles down. So, you know, if the boss was stuck up and was a jerk, the band guys would have a bad attitude and they'd be upset because, oh, the boss was, you know, talking crap about us.
Pretty happy
so
work now, environment we have out there.
Yeah, so all around, I mean, it trickles down. So there's a lot to be said from, you know, how you're treated from the top down. So
you got to feed your crew, right? The local catering has been great. It's been really impressive.
They've been doing pretty good, yeah. It's hard to feed
100 people.
100 people.
4 meals a day.
Yeah.
4-3-4 miles a day.
Well, I mean, with getting back to Vaynerchuk, I mean, one thing is I was going to put on.
Maybe Gary Vee will be a guest on our show. Maybe Grant Cardone.
We'd love that.
Maybe Grant Cardone will be a guest. You know, the whole concept behind this podcast is we're starting with the low-hanging fruit in my experience, which is people in the music business. Mm-hmm. But we will be interviewing authors, actors, CEOs, people that are successful in their line of work across the globe.
Mm-hmm. All sorts of different businesses, walks of life.
Yes.
I'm going to reach out to Michael Burt to see if he'd be a guest. He'd be a great guest. And that's the other thing I was going to say was if anybody who's watching this currently has a connection to Gary Vee or wants to blow us up and get on his radar, feel free to do so.
Yeah.
That would be wonderful. But no other questions that I can really see at this point. If anybody else has got something, if Rich, you want to head towards wrapping it up, that'd be fantastic.
Yeah, hey, an episode of Pick Rich's Brain would not be complete with a little bit of promo sexuality. So what do we want to talk about. Remind me what to talk about in Drumming in the Modern World. I just want to let you guys and gals know out there, there's a website that exists called drumminginthemodernworld.com, and on that is 120 educational films that I've created over a three-year period. John cleaned, tuned, prepped five drum sets for this thing. He did a lot of the digital editing for it. My friend Eric Doris directed. Chris Beals did second camera. We filmed it and recorded it through an SSL board over at Black River Entertainment, Ronnie's place, where everyone has recorded. I mean, Johnny Cash, Dixie Chicks, Miranda Lambert. So it's a classic recording studio. I shot it in several camera angles. Everything I know about drumming so far to this point in my life. A lot of cool takeaway information. $150, you get almost 7 hours of educational stuff. So we'd love for you to stop by and check that out. And there's all sorts of other things that people don't know exist unless they just stumble upon my website, richredmond.com, which is, if you go to my products page, every Jason Aldean song ever recorded by yours truly is transcribed. So if you are a teacher, or you're a drum teacher, or you're a college student, you want to work on playing the Nashville pop country rock thing that we have kind of been working on in the last 15 years, you can play along and read and work on your reading. So that stuff exists. And then check out my YouTube channel, youtube.com/RichRedmond, R-E-D-M-O-N-D, because for 12 years, I've been populating that thing with almost 400 takeaway videos about everything about drumming and motivation and behind the scenes and tips. And it's all free.
Eviscerating yourself.
Yeah.
Jim Hanley just joined.
There's Jim Hanley. There's our Jim Hanley. Jim Hanley. We just talked about Jim Hanley.
Guest number six. Huh?
Guest number six. Jim was actually the first drum tech teacher at my first annual Drummers Weekend, which we had in the Hyatt Place Hotel in Cool Springs. And since then, as it expanded to our friends at Soundcheck, the big room at Soundcheck, we have 25 students and then world-class drummers. And that thing, I should let you know, I haven't hired the talent for the teachers this year, but it's going to be world-class teachers. I'm thinking maybe Daniel De Los Reyes, the percussionist from the Zac Brown Band. Maybe Garrett Goodwin from from Carrie Underwood's band. So many amazing talents. We'll never have to repeat ourselves because there's so many great drummers in Nashville. But that's happening November 3 through 5 in Nashville. It's 72 hours of hands-on training. You can go to richredmond.com and you could lock your slot in with a down payment, and that'll secure your position. And who signed up? I know who signed up so far. My buddy Sarah Cardeal, my favorite student up in Connecticut. She's all ready to go. So that's going to be
third time student?
Yeah, she's going to be for her third year, actually.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
We have a great time because you get, at the end of the event, you get to play with a live killer band in front of, Kevin Murphy would say, you get to play with a live band in front of a live audience? What? How much does that cost?
Wait, who said that?
Kevin Murphy.
Don't know him.
You know,
sorry, Kevin. Joking.
If we had Murfquake on here, the room would explode with crazy, insane energy because we're like two magnets that are just like this. But I know we're probably going to get our buddy Greg Glazer on here. Is it Glazer or Glazer?
I want to say Glazer.
I want to say, okay, Greg, like Glazer. He's focused like a laser, but he's one of the top salespeople, GC Pro.
He is the salesperson.
He is the guy. Yeah. I mean, he's like, when you come in, he's like, he's not even looking at the keyboard, and he's like, oh, what do you need? Oh, I got that in stock, no problem. He's that guy. Talk about salesmanship. So we're going to have him out. We're going to talk about sales.
He should be a speaker at your Drummers Weekend. In addition to me, doing
thank
sales.
You. Oh, my God. That's thank you for
idea.
Telling me this.
It's a great idea.
Greg, you are hired. I'm going to feed you. We'll work for food.
It's top-notch class.
Yeah.
There's actually another good question.
Okay.
That came in compliment.
Oh, wait, it sounds like it's...
I mean it that way. How often do you have to change cymbals during a tour?
Only when they break. We don't change them until they break.
I know,
but that's Drew Connor Wilson.
I think that's what Drew is asking. How many cymbals do I break?
Oh.
Two a year?
Maybe two crash cymbals, one China. We broke a set of hi-hats 2 weeks ago, but it's the first set in 3 years that we broke, so it's very few, very few.
Yeah, we love our friends at Sabian.
Yeah, they take great care of us. They melt them back down, so we break a cymbal. We call them up and say, hey, we broke a cymbal. We mail a cymbal out, they mail a new cymbal back. We're happy, they're
Who
happy.
Who knew that a cymbal company would be green thumbs all the way? Matter of fact, a lot of these drum companies, whether it be from Promark planting 75 trees, you know, or they plant a pretty they plant a tree for every 75 pairs of drumsticks. I don't know the math, but it's cool. They are restocking the forest, and the state of California has certified Remo as one of the top green companies in the state of California, and the melting down the cymbals, and then DW makes drums out of bamboo and all sorts of cool. So like, there's some good stuff happening out there for the ecology.
DW made drums out of Lake Superior wood.
Yeah, Good will make a drum out of anything, and it's magic.
Yeah.
Hey, Rich, how do I get my right foot as fast as yours? Go, go, Ray.
Oh, my God, go, go, Ray. You are a funny man. I would say, so go, go, Ray, he is being tongue in cheek because he has the fastest right foot. He probably plays double bass. We don't even know about it. And it's just his left foot is just as fast. But Go-Go Ray is a killer player. He's playing with Mike Dillon. He plays with people all over the Kansas City area. But I got to know him in Denton, Texas when I was getting my master's degree. And I would go to his place called Rick's Place that burnt down. But I would go and there was a banister, and I would watch from above with my jaw agape because Go-Go Ray could play like, a human being plays that, and that's Go-Go Ray. So Go-Go Ray is being funny because he knows the fastest I can play are two 30-second notes that precede a snare drum backbeat. Like, I've made an art out of that. I've paid my mortgage doing that, but I have the slowest foot in the business. Thank you, Go-Go Ray. Everyone check out Go-Go Ray.
Okay, so.
So that's it.
Yeah,
so we've talked to all things tech.
All things teching.
This is John. John, how can everybody keep in touch with you and find you?
Keep in touch with me via Instagram at Johnny Fletch Drums. If you want to reach out to me directly to talk about drum tuning lessons, drum lessons recording at my studio, john@johnnyfletch.com is my email. So you can reach out to me directly about any of that you would like to know more about or pursue.
What are you calling your studio? Johnny's Place or
Hallway Studios?
Hallway Studios.
Nice.
Hallway Studios.
H-U-L-L.
And it is in the hall. It is in the
W-A-Y
hall.
W-A-Y.
I have a question.
Studios.
Actually, this is kind of getting off of thank you. From Drew, he says, you have your drum mat marked, but one of the things that when I was playing out a lot years and years and years ago is the height of the cymbal stands. How do you collapse them and remember the
height? I don't collapse them.
You don't collapse them.
And if you did, there's this amazing technology called memory locks that DW makes.
Yep.
And you just take the top of the stand out. And then you put it back in
then
the next day.
You mark them somehow.
You have to color coat because you don't want the wrong cymbals to be at the wrong height. So color coat your stands, tighten your memory lock, and you just break it in half, and you slide it perfectly the next day.
And I would say come see us this year on this They Don't Know tour. We're going to do 85 shows for sure. It's my favorite drum set. I haven't been able to beat this drum set. It's as a matter of fact, Jim McCarthy just did a gear rundown video. If you go to my YouTube page, look up Rich Redmond Gear Rundown 2017.
It's our third tour with this.
It's for third tour. We can't beat this drum set. It's black sparkle. I love black, and it's got white satin hardware, so it looks super masculine, super tough. We made a transition from, I've been using smooth whites for about a decade, and then we went to coated whites for about 3 or 4 years, and now we're on
clear emperors.
I'm really, really, really enjoying them, but the height of the drum riser, where I'm located on stage, the way the guys can come and kind of, we can feed off each other's energy is really, really fantastic. And my buddy Kurt Allison, who I've been playing with for 20 years, wrote the song They Don't Know, which is the title of the record, the title of the new single, and the title of the tour, so congratulations to Kurt Allison.
Yeah.
So we talked drum teching. We talked about the Crash Concept for Success. We talked about all sorts of fun
stuff. Did we congratulate Jason for the Country Hall of Fame?
Oh, the Country Hall of Fame. The Country Hall of Fame. It was just 2 nights ago that I was at the Country Music Hall of Fame, which is this famed institution here in Nashville. Little Nashville, Tennessee is the third fastest growing city in America. 100 people a day moving here. If you're not here, you better get here. The Country Music Hall of Fame was honoring Jason with an exhibit. And you can see things like his pajamas and his rocking horse and his first baseball bat, and then you can see that the way he dressed in some memorabilia from the last 12 years of nonstop touring. But I am celebrating 18 years of working with Jason as a friend and as a fellow music maker and employer. So I would go check that out. It's probably going to be there for a couple of months. And there's a signed drumhead from the whole band there behind the glass. And I will say, an exhibit like that is probably easier to maintain than having to feed the gorilla or the lion at the San Diego Zoo.
I don't want to feed the gorilla or the lion
at the San Diego Zoo. No,
I like my hands.
Yeah.
And my bones intact.
It's fine. I
mean, Sean Deal with the quote of the day. Tell the guys, excuse me, do you mind?
Excuse me,
do you mind? Has anybody been any fans out there of Curb Your Enthusiasm? Larry David is a comic genius. Excuse me.
Sean's on the other side of the phone going like this.
Great stuff. I mean, you can watch those episodes over and over. Are they an hour or 30 minutes? They're an hour.
49 minutes,
okay, yeah. 49 minutes, okay.
47.
But per your request, you're approaching the hour mark.
Per my request.
That's right.
Yeah.
Per Jack. There's an inside joke. I'll tell you about that if we do a private lesson. But guys, I am so easy to keep in touch with. I'm a sitting duck on the Googleator. This podcast will be at Google Play. It'll be on Stitcher. It'll be on iTunes. It'll exist on my website under media at richredmond.com. And of course, it'll exist on YouTube. Give us a couple of days to put this thing together. Big hand for my right-hand man, Jim McCarthy, jimmccarthyvoiceovers.com.
Yes.
Jon Hull, we really appreciate it. This has been episode 5 of Pick Rich's Brain. Send me your questions. Use the hashtag PickRich'sBrain, no apostrophe. Thanks again to the Tipping Chair Tavern for being our first sponsor, and we will see you soon.